Hello everyone, this is Dario from Spain, and before we begin this interview, let me just say sorry if my accent isn't the best, since English is not my native language, but nonetheless I think a great interview awaits. We've got with us Robert David Steele, a former CIA case officer, and I prepared a series of interesting questions for him to answer. Robert, it's great to have you on with us.
Glad to be here.
Tell us a bit about your career and how you got introduced to the intelligence world.
Well, I was born to a U.S. father and a Colombian mother, whose roots actually go back to Catalan in the 17th century. And I grew up as the son of an oil engineer. I then went back to school and did a thesis on multinational corporations and home host country issues. Did a graduate thesis on predicting revolution, and then turned down a job from Wall Street and joined the Marine Corps. From the Marine Corps, where I was bored, it was peace, I joined the Central Intelligence Agency. I did three back-to-back tours overseas, including one chasing terrorists for the first time in the 1980s. Then three more tours in Washington. I was selected by the Marine Corps to create the Marine Corps Intelligence Activity, a new National Intelligence Analysis Center. And from there in 1993, I resigned because the U.S. government refused to take open source intelligence seriously. I spent 20 years helping over 66 countries, over 7,500 mid-career officers learn about open source intelligence. And I have since morphed, if you will, into someone who champions open source everything. And just today, I have submitted to the United Nations a proposed initiative for going beyond data monitoring to create a United Nations Open Source Decision Support Information Network, UNODIN, which would, I believe, substantially improve the ability of the United Nations to achieve the Sustainability Development Goals. And I'm sorry that's so long, but that is my life in a nutshell.
Awesome. So I'm also interested in knowing what woke you up. Was it a single event or was it a process? What was it?
Well, it's interesting because I'm not a normal American. I grew up overseas. I was much more familiar with reality overseas and with some of the problems of our own causing. But what woke me up was when I spent $20 million on a top secret intelligence analysis center and my analysts started lining up for the single PC that I had over in a corner. That's when I realized that the U.S. government was ignorant and hollow.
Talk us about the open source project. If I'm not mistaken, among other things, it's based on the universal access to all kinds of information available, isn't it? Or
yes. Well, open source intelligence essentially means decision support, which is based on sources that are open and ethically and legally available. Now, one of the problems that we have in the United States is that we only speak English. And of course, I speak for effect, but if you look at our Arab translators, they're generally from Lebanon and they stink at dialects of Arabic other than the Lebanon version. We don't actually do the 20 languages spoken in India. We don't actually do serious Chinese. So part of the problem that we have here is the United States government is spending $100 billion a year on stealing secrets and on mass surveillance that it does not process. It does not do what is called decision support for whole of government. For example, agriculture, energy, health, water. It just doesn't do it. So we have a government that's organized into stovepipes that are ignorant, and our policies are made by who pays to be heard rather than by what is in the best interest of the taxpayer.
And how can folks get your book if they are interested?
Well, all of my books are free online, except for the last one, but at Phi Beta Iota, the public intelligence blog, www.phibetaiota.net, you can use the page that is marked books and get to my books at Amazon and also get to my books where they're free online. I've just gotten the translation rights back to my latest book, and that's going to be free online in Spanish by December.
Great. You know, I really liked when you said in one interview that the intelligence community is actually not very intelligent because, you know, not everyone in there, but a lot of people are, you know, focused on directing drones that are just killing innocent people and just maybe even enraging more the radical Islam or whatever ideologies in those parts of the world. So I also believe that that applies to the elites too, because why would they want to be the only ones successful when we know that if everyone was given a chance, which is possible nowadays, technology would advance so rapidly, but instead they want to keep living in their little bubble while putting the whole planet and ecosystem at risk. Isn't that right?
Well, yes, and in fact, I have to say I have mixed feelings about secret intelligence because I do believe that secret intelligence and secret counterintelligence is absolutely essential because there are organizations, including Zionist, fascists, criminals, people doing illegal banking on a massive scale. They have to be penetrated with secrecy. So there still is a need for spies and secrecy. But where we have lost it is in failing to see that the public is the golden goose. The public is the productivity engine. The public is what actually creates wealth. We are coming off 50 years in which the financial industry has been extracting wealth and becoming an absentee landlord and essentially not investing in infrastructure. And at the same time, the elites have finally achieved what they wanted. They wanted a world in which 100% of the governments were either failed states or totally corrupt and responsive to the elites. And what they have discovered is that this doesn't help them because the public is now very, very upset. The Arab Spring is just the beginning of what I believe will be a worldwide revolution. And I expect that Catalan and Scotland and many other places will eventually have their own autonomy. Because absentee government, like absentee landlords, does not work. Now, what's positive here is that a fraction of the elites are breaking away. Lady Lynn Rothschild in London just sponsored a conference on inclusive capitalism. The Mars family has sponsored an issue of a journal that's focused on mutuality economics. And there are what we call the black sheep billionaires in both Europe and on the west coast of the United States that are talking about redemptive capitalism. And what all of these movements among this fraction of the 1% that's breaking free, what they're all focused on is how do we stop the pitchforks? How do we settle the public? And I have a very simple answer for that. You settle the public by getting out of the way. I believe in truth and reconciliation. I absolutely believe that we should not be threatening the 1%. We should not even be thinking about confiscating their wealth. We should, however, be taking back labor control of productivity and labor control of land. And if we do that, and if we use information technology, and my report to the United Nations, which is now available online, it's a tiny URL /EIN-UN-SDG. That report suggests that we start empowering people with a combination of true cost economic information and open source everything engineering. So let me stop there and come back to you.
Okay, now that you've mentioned Zionism, to which extent do you believe Israel has power over US policies and therefore over the world?
Well, I distinguish between the Zionist fascist government of Israel and the good American Jews and the American and the Israeli Jews that are all appalled at what's being done to Palestine. Unfortunately, the U.S. Congress is 100% corrupt. Even Bernie Sanders is a facade. The U.S. Congress is no longer making decisions in the public interest. It's making decisions that it's being paid to make. And among all of the lobbyists, there are two that are truly toxic to the United States of America and to the world. The first is Zionism, and the second is Saudi Arabia.
Also, explain to the audience these different kinds of economies the elites are considering. What do every one of these options consist of, and do you believe Mars's family option is the best out there?
Well, I would certainly recommend that Marxism be understood in the way that it's explained in a wonderful book called Stop Thief. And I've reviewed that book, And in that book, you have the five gates of Marxism, and I think all five of those gates need to be understood. I will not, however, go so far as to recommend Marxism or communism, or even pure socialism. What I do believe is that the word capitalism should never again be used, because capitalism is essentially the dominance of production by finance. Finance is a toxic, predatory branch of economics, and it is totally corrupt and totally toxic. Where I think we need to move is to what the Mars family calls mutuality economics. Some others call it reciprocity economics. There are a whole number of terms, including collaborative economy, sharing economy, peer-to-peer economy, so forth. I will not review all of those. What it boils down to is every person on the planet can have and should have, with the technologies we have today for solar power and water desalination and hydroponics and creating homes with embedded sanitation from the Global Village construction set, everybody on the planet should have enough. And where we have gone wrong is allowing the concentration of wealth, the creation of false digital wealth. I mean, the Koch brothers earn $3 million in false digital money every hour on interest. That's insane. So we're out of control. So I think we need to basically kill financial capitalism. We need to reject the word capitalism. And we need to come up with an economics of abundance rather than scarcity, in which labor and the needs of the people and the absolute responsibility to protect the land and protect the earth, these need to be paramount.
Okay, also, energy. Do you believe that Russia's new power initiatives will force the US to let some real options emerge, such as maybe geothermal, like I've seen you mention too, or any of these? Do you believe that we'll see a rise of the usage of these technologies, or?
Well, the short answer is no, because Russia is still playing industrial era politics. I mean, Russia's made some major advances in the Arctic, and I believe that Russia is trying to milk the fossil fuel pattern, and Russia is not, as it should be, actually fostering renewable energies. I would certainly like to see Brazil, China, and India, as well as Indonesia and perhaps Turkey and Iran, take the lead in pressing forward in not just solar energy and geothermal and other renewable energies, but we're now starting to see some major breakthroughs, for example, at the University of Glasgow, in creating energy from the division of water between oxygen and hydrogen. The technologies are out there. They're being repressed. And this is an area where I think the United Nations could play a role. Because what we have right now is an educational system and a media system that are both totally captive to capitalist interests. The educational system and the media system today are worthless in terms of actually helping the public learn and innovate. So I believe that Russia is not doing all that it could. And I would like to see what comes out of Brazil, China, and Indonesia, and India, among others.
Okay. Also, do you see the rise of corporate ownership in the web by Google, Facebook, Microsoft, etc., as a threat to the freedom of information?
Yeah, no, they certainly, I mean, Google and Facebook are criminal enterprises. I don't trust them. I canceled my Facebook account. If I could find a way to more easily transfer out of Google, I would certainly stop using everything that Google offers. Google, by its own admission, indexes less than 0.04 of the internet. Everything else is deep web. Google has failed to make sense. Google has led the violation of privacy. There is no separation between Google and the National Security Agency. And the same is true of Microsoft and IBM and HP and Dell and Facebook and Twitter. They are all completely co-opted enterprises responsive to the National Security Agency and its mass surveillance. Now, the good news is the National Security Agency doesn't actually process all of the stuff that it collects. It is primarily about spending vast amounts of money. The other good news is I believe a Google killer is within 2 to 3 years of emerging. What is happening now is that power is moving down to the local level, localization. And I believe that open source everything information technology, building on, for example, Ushandi and crisis mappers and OpenStreetMap and so forth, I think we're a hair away from creating a people's intelligence network. And when that happens, and when we can break down all the barriers to information sharing and sense making across all of the civil society groups, then I believe you will find that nonviolent strikes and tax revolts are going to become the norm.
Don't you believe also that the power structure, elites, or whatever you want to call it, they underestimated the power of the internet? Because I think a lot of, you know, frauds are being exposed through it. And obviously, if we only were left with the mainstream media, we would have no idea of a lot of issues that are going on.
Well, yes and no. I consider the internet to be largely crap right now. And I certainly consider Wikipedia to be the crap leader. Most of what you get on the internet is garbage. And unfortunately, the few bright shining lights, Tong, Engelbart, a few of the other sites, are not seen by enough people. Furthermore, the internet does not provide for holistic analytics. It does not provide for the rapid documentation and sharing of true cost economic information such that we can boycott specific products and companies worldwide, although I certainly recommend to everyone that they look at a website called www.buycott.com. The day is going to come when we the people can change markets overnight. We the people should be able to put Coca-Cola, Nestle, and Monsanto out of business within 30 to 90 days. All it takes is a proper application of the internet such that we all have the information that we need, we make our own decisions, and then we act as a multi-billion dollar force that cannot be stopped.
Also, Bycott, I think, has a mobile application. Actually, I have it in my phone, and to the audience who doesn't know, it basically lets you, it scans the codes of products and lets you see if the corporation who owns it is corrupt. So I would urge you all to download it because it's very useful.
Okay. Yes, it is. However, it's looking through the wrong end of the telescope. What it doesn't do is tell you that the product that you're looking at has 100 gallons of water and has used up 15 gallons of fuel and has released X number of toxins into the air. And oh, by the
child
way,
labor.
it's based on child labor, and the company in question has been avoiding paying taxes. So we need to get down to the product level of intelligence for the public.
Speaking of the internet, Snowden, I've heard you talk about how the Chinese were behind his actions. Can you tell us a little more about that?
I have not said that.
Sorry.
I have speculated about Snowden, and my current thinking is he may actually be a CIA operation against the NSA, approved by Obama, because Obama has evidently been blackmailed by NSA, among others. No, I don't blame China for Snowden. I think Snowden has had an extraordinarily positive impact. The difference between Snowden and myself is that I am not a whistleblower. I've never violated the law. I've never taken that risk. I commend Snowden for having done so. Whether or not he was actually pushed out there by CIA and Booz Allen. And I absolutely believe that the public has a need to know everything that Snowden has been trying to put before them. But no, the Chinese have been doing very well in information operations. They learned how to ride the electrical circuits into NSA's computers and also the NORAD computers. And that is frankly the dirtiest little secret that NSA doesn't want Congress to know, that the Chinese have been living inside NSA computers for at least 10 years. So in the United States, secrecy is not actually used to protect serious secrets. It's used to keep people from knowing just how bad we are.
Another touchy thing about the subject is the fact that Greenwald, who, if I'm not mistaken, he now has all the documents of that Snowden leaked. He had, maybe you've heard about this already, probably, but he made a multi-million-dollar deal with the someone very powerful from PayPal. I think it was one of the directors, $250 million, who even made comments against whistleblowers in the past and seems to have pro-establishment views. What do you make of this?
I have no knowledge of this.
Okay. Being a student, I get the impression that school testing all over the world is designed to measure submission to certain rules and arbitrary academic parameters instead of very important pillars of human knowledge like emotional intelligence and moral values. Do you agree, and why do you think this has taken
Look,
place?
I absolutely agree. In fact, I broke down in tears when I was at a conference in Scotland because I realized as I was listening to some of these wise people that I had sentenced my three boys to 12 years in prison. Prison is what we call traditional schooling. The fact is, excellent books have been written. Gatto has written a book called Weapons of Mass Instruction. The fact is that schools are designed to train factory workers and they're designed to create submissive employees. There are other great books such as Orbiting the Giant Hairball, which point out that we beat the creativity out of students by the time they're in the fourth or fifth grade. Education today is completely broken, completely inappropriate. It needs to be burned to the ground and built over. And those of us like you and me, and thankfully my three boys that survived the educational system, we're the ones that need to build the new system. And I will tell you that Earth Intelligence Network, which I funded when I had money before the US government destroyed my business in 2006, Earth Intelligence Network has come to the conclusion that the next major educational system and the next major media system is going to be rooted in an honest search network. Baidu comes to mind, Yandex in Russia come to mind. We believe that education needs to be one cellular access to the internet instance at a time. And that the only thing that needs to be done in a structured way is to teach children how to read and write, and perhaps begin them toward understanding how to do creative thinking and structured thinking. But after that, they need to be liberated.
Okay, there are some strong indicators, as I've heard you call them, coming from the intelligence community, regarding the deliberate endangerment by governmental authorities through negligence in both Western Ebola cases in Spain and in the US. What do you make of this? Is this simply hype and a scare tactic, or do you entertain the idea that Ebola is wished to spread by the powers that be?
Well, first off, there's no such thing as a monolithic US government. In fact, I've published a post on how there are seven CIAs, not one CIA. So you are constantly going to have tensions between those portions of the government that are attempting to be legitimate and do their job with ethics and integrity, and then rogue elements of the government, plus other rogue elements of the private sector, including Saudi Arabia and Israel. If Ebola breaks out in Latin America, it would not surprise me to find that Saudi Arabia was behind it, or that Israel was behind it, or that a rogue element of the CIA was behind it. Certainly, we have a lot of experience seeing that rogue elements of the US government have conducted false flag operations, including the FBI. And we're now at a point where nobody trusts the US government. Nobody believes anything the US government says, including the unemployment rate. The actual unemployment rate in the United States of America today, according to shadowstats.com, is 22.4%, not 7%, not 6%. So false flags are with us. I'm not ready to say that Ebola is being spread deliberately by any legitimate element of the U.S. government, but I will say that I think that the CDC, which is supposed to be a legal element of the U.S. government, the CDC has been irresponsible. And I'll give you one specific example. The N95 mask that they have been recommending to first responders and nurses is, I am told, only good to 0.3 microns. Ebola is actually transmitted in the air through fluids by 0.08 microns, which is to say the Ebola micron is one third the size of the smallest opening in the approved mask. So from where I sit, CDC has been grossly irresponsible. It has failed to properly inform the president and everybody else. It is covering up its inadequacies, and we are 10 months too late in being responsible about Ebola.
Yes, the whole issue is definitely very weird, because even here in Spain, it surfaced pretty quick how the nurse that got infected even contacted the hospital and said, "Hey, I think I have a fever. This can't be normal." She just treated two cases of Ebola, and they just turned her away.
Well, you know, don't forget that on the other side of every conspiracy is sheer bureaucratic incompetence. And I love Spain and I love the United States, but in my experience, 70% of the bureaucrats are morons who shouldn't be paid for with the public treasury.
Okay. Also, do you see the total ban of weapons in virtually all Europe as a potential danger to its citizens in the near future in case of a systemic collapse?
Well, if Europe collapses, the weapons will very quickly become available. We have put so many small arms into the Middle East and elsewhere that the marketplace will very quickly arm the people of Europe. And those that can't be armed will find a way to ambush government and police patrols, and they will arm themselves from the government. I'm not that worried about it, but I will say that I am an absolute fervent supporter of the U.S. constitutional right to bear arms, and I absolutely believe that democracy only occurs when the government fears the people. And that's certainly not the case in Europe, and it's not the case in the United States.
Yes, in Europe, it's weird, like everyone is very brainwashed to fear arms so much. But also, you know, when I thought about it, it's not that people don't want any weapons. You want the government to have the monopoly of them, and that's a very dangerous thing in my opinion, because
you're right, and again, it all comes back to responsibility. There is a wonderful book, Will Durant, who with his wife Ariel wrote the multi-volume Story of Civilization, and he's written some excellent capstone books including The Lessons of History. His 1916 doctoral thesis is now available as a book, Philosophy and the Social Problem. And what it boils down to is that the absolute most important responsibility of any community is to educate its children. And if you educate your children and you teach them ethics and responsibility, then those children, properly armed, are your best defense. If you abdicate the task of education and you abdicate the task of protection to a government that does not have at its core these ethical, educated citizens, then you are essentially turning over all of your rights to a criminal gang.
Yes, also creating laws, most of the time, in my opinion at least, it's like a very easy way to confront a problem. It has a lot of psychological roots, and to say, no, okay, that's just banned from now on, it's like a very easy thing to do, and irresponsible even, in my opinion at least, only to do so, don't you think?
I'm going to compress it into the essence of the establishment of laws. It appears that years ago, in order to manage tribes and small communities, it was very difficult to manage people unless they invented laws. Now, the tribe leader always got the best of the deal, as a rule. And in order to assure that be perpetuated, laws are invented. Laws originate only because of scarcity. If you have difficulty making that connection, imagine fruit growing all over the world on every tree. There would be no laws as to how much fruit you can eat if it grew all over the place. Only when food is scarce does laws come in. Not only food, but when anything is scarce, man makes laws as to who gets what. And naturally, the control group of any society gets the best. And that's the way the law is set. You think man makes laws to make life better for people? No, it's to manage scarcity. So if we move toward the production of an abundance, the amount of laws will diminish, directly proportionate to how much we eliminate scarcity. People think man makes laws so that life will be better for people. Not necessarily. Sometimes it's better for the control group or the selected few rather than the majority.
Look, I'm terribly worried about government irresponsibility, because if you look at what the government has failed to do on the environment, if you look at every single issue area from agriculture to water, governments are being irresponsible. In fact, the EU right now is mandating changes to agriculture that are killing Swedish agriculture. So the EU has become ignorant and irresponsible about self-sustaining agriculture and other practices. And the same can be said about any issue area, whether it's pharmaceuticals and health or energy or whatever. One of the problems that we have is that society has become fragmented and ignorant, and governments are essentially being bribed to be very, very evil. So I think we need to move back toward localization. We need to move back to where communities are governed by themselves, by people that know each other and that have over time built up trust in each other.
Okay, a well-known topic is the use of fear by the elites to gain control over the population. To what degree do you believe this is true? And do you think that there have been some major events perpetrated with no other intent than scaring the public? Or maybe not only to terrorize, but to serve as a political diversion?
Well, the single most important event in this modern era is 9/11. And I will just point everyone toward the superb work of Richard Gage and the architects and engineers for 9/11 Truth. There's also a post at Phi Beta Iota, which you can find easily by searching for Mini-Me 9/11 Convergence. And that summarizes what Gage and his others have found. I am absolutely certain that 9/11 was allowed to happen. Dick Cheney scheduled a counterterrorism exercise 3 months in advance of 9/11 for that date. 13 countries are on record as having warned us in advance of 9/11. So for me, 9/11 is the ultimate false flag in this century. And there have been other false flag efforts, and I don't want to spend too much time on this because I am focused now on the positive and on empowering the public, and I'm basically routing around government. But 9/11 was absolutely allowed to happen and was something that was used to strike fear into the public, to militarize the police, to neutralize Congress, and to allow us to go to war in Iraq on the basis of 935 now documented lies.
I know you don't want to talk about this a lot, but my next question was about 9/11 precisely. So,
no, keep going.
Okay. In order to ask the next question, I would like to tell you very quickly how I first got introduced to this world of reading between the lines, if you will. I first got introduced by some major occultist themes such as the Illuminati and secret societies, but later I got away from it because I figured knowing these crazy people's rituals wasn't the key to have an impact on the world. But now that I've learned more information about false flags and all these wars, I've been thinking, wow, these people really must love projecting suffering to some extent. They already have massive amounts of wealth, yet it seems they don't get enough of causing chaos throughout the world. Do you believe some of these people at the top are really into what they do? And do you believe aspects of their major false flags have ritualistic connotations? Some people will argue that practices like numerology were deeply involved in 9/11.
I'm not qualified and I don't care to speculate. I will just say two things. The first is that there are rituals, including pedophilia and the abuse of children and sex trade in small children. I think these are considered an elite privilege in certain circles, and they're also used as a means of blackmailing one another. There is a lot of really ugly, ugly stuff that characterizes a broad swath of the elite, and the Federal Bureau of Investigation, to be very specific, appears to have been told by its political masters that it cannot and must not actually run operations to stop trafficking in children among the elites. So I'm very concerned by that. And in fact, that could be, if that ever comes out publicly in a big way, that could be a precipitant for revolution. And if I were the elites, I would be thinking seriously about self-policing. As far as insensitivity, as best I can tell, the people who inherit wealth are out of touch with reality. They really do think that they're better than we are, and they really do think that we're nothing more than farm animals and we're expendable. And that is, in my view, one of the best reasons for having universal military service and for having public schools and eliminating private schools. Because if we do not come up together as a community, then this kind of fragmentation will persist. And inherited wealth right now is the single greatest likely cause of a violent revolution across Europe and the United States.
Okay. Continuing, I think most of the audience knows about the controlled demolitions and everything. And if not, I would advise people to check out, for example, like you said, Gage interview on C-SPAN very recently. That was, I was very amazed to see such a fair interview in the mainstream media. Normally, they bring these kinds of people just to try to ridicule them. For example, well, go ahead.
Well, Gage was on C-SPAN because hundreds of thousands of people across the United States have been writing C-SPAN for the last 2 years, 2 or 3 years. And the media, the people who actually work for the media are not stupid. They're just slaves. These people know as well as we do that 9/11 was a contrived event, but they are on a payroll. And unfortunately, in this era, if you're not part of the system with a pigeonhole and a salary that's paid for by the system, you may not survive. We have way too many intelligent people with ethics who are technically homeless and who have no salary, no pension, and no savings. So I believe that we're at a turning point. And I believe that sometime in the next couple of years, we're going to see a massive public awakening. And I believe that what will happen slowly is that a mix of political parties, such as the Pirate Party, will finally begin to break down the two-party tyrannies that are so characteristic of Europe and the United States. And at that point, we will start to see common sense come back in the government.
Now, we all know the buildings were brought down by controlled demolitions, but was that really single-handedly responsible for the mass destruction that day? You know, there's a man called Dmitry Kalesov, who is an ex-KGB and an expert in nuclear demolitions.
Are directed energy weapons the best explanation? Or could nuclear reactions better account for the phenomena?
Like any other nuclear weapon, the Davy Crockett gives off three basic effects: heat, blast, and nuclear radiation.
Notice the geometry of this nuclear explosion.
And he's written some very interesting information about...
Right. Look, I've seen that. I'm not going to talk about 9/11 anymore.
Okay.
There is a lot of information about 9/11 at Phi Beta Iota. We have over 80 active contributing editors. And I certainly am happy to have people see that. We also have that nuclear theory at 9/11. I mean, at Phi Beta Iota. But please, let's move on. I will not talk about 9/11
okay.
anymore.
Since you are the number one nonfiction book reviewer on Amazon, please recommend me and to the audience five books that can help people understand the world better, or maybe just your favorite ones.
That's a lovely question, and I want to say that I read in 98 categories, and all 98 categories can be inspected. All of my reviews in each of the 98 categories can be found at Phi Beta Iota by clicking on the review page at the very top. And I also have lists of books. For example, I have a list of books on self-determination and secession, which should be of great interest to my friends in Catalan. But I would say my first and most favorite book is Will Durant's Philosophy and the Social Problem, followed by Will and Ariel Durant's The Lessons of History. And one of the lessons that they say is that morality is a strategic asset of priceless proportions. And where I think our governments have gone wrong is they have completely abdicated their responsibilities for ethics and for morality. And therefore, they have lost their legitimacy. And when you lose your legitimacy, you can no longer govern. So those two books by the Durants, I would say, are important. Here's another one. In fact, I just finished reviewing this. And it's by Micah Sifri, whose stupid publisher is not properly presenting the book on Amazon. And so I hope everyone will go and try to buy the book on Amazon, and absolutely do not buy the book from the publisher at their website. This book by Micah, The Big Disconnect, Why the Internet Hasn't Transformed Politics Yet, is in my view a critical evaluation of why all of the civil society organizations are not working well together, and on why we continue to lack tools. It's just like when CIA was funding student movements across the United States in the 1960s. It was giving just enough money to thousands of organizations so that they would all do their own thing and they would not work together. The foundations have done precisely the same thing to all the non-governmental organizations. They are all scattered and fragmented and not working well together. Now, I was inspired by Micah's book, and so I have a new book that I'm starting work on, in fact, this week. I've just had the publisher approve the table of contents, and it's called Revolution. And it's an open source everything action handbook, And it is going to try and set the stage for giving us the tools and the knowledge that we need to come together and be a force more powerful than any government. So that would be the third book. On fourth and fifth and sixth books, these would be tough choices, but I suppose that Vaclav Havel's The Power of the Powerless is an important work, because the fact is neither governments nor the wealthy can continue if we refuse to work. We the people have the absolute power of saying no. And I continue to be stunned at how effective the schools and the media have been at turning everybody into a slave that obeys orders without question.
Okay, so closing comments now. I know you have a positive outlook of the future. What do you see happening? Any concrete social consequences? For example, here in Spain, a very successful party has emerged all of a sudden, and he's called Pablo Iglesias, and he's talking about how our money system is a complete fraud and very hardcore comments. Do you think that this is gonna happen all over the world now, like a third political option that is more critical of the establishment, or what kinds of consequences do you see arising?
Well, I think local money and a confiscation of land that is now owned by absentee landlords. I think we need to revert to community-owned land. And this is the case in France and in portions of Mexico and elsewhere. I believe the concept of allowing an absentee landlord to own land in a community has got to go. And I believe that the initiatives that work will be local. The problem with parties like the Pirate Party and this new Iglesias party is that they're playing the old game. And that will allow the legacy two-party tyranny to basically string them out for another decade. So I don't place a lot of faith in new parties. And I don't place a lot of faith in anyone that is trying to work within the system. I myself have wasted 25 years trying to help governments get a grip on open sources of information and make decisions responsibly in the public interest. And what I realize now is I should have focused from the very beginning on empowering one village at a time. And so that's where I think the revolution will be made, one village at a time, with local money and absolute ownership of the land around the village.
Okay, I want to thank you very much for your time, Robert, and it would be great maybe in a year or so to have another interview, but we'll see. Anyway, thanks a lot.
Para mí ha sido un gran placer. Hasta luego.
Hasta luego.